to seven. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 to 7. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice, from henceforth even forever. The seal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Amen.
Amen.
The significance of Christmas. The significance of Christmas. In the last few days, I've seen some non-believers post trying to ridicule Christmas, trying to challenge why we Christians celebrate Christmas, arguing themselves that we have been disillusioned, or that we don't even know what we are doing, that we are being misled. That Christmas, as far as they are concerned, it's nothing more than the capitalist invention to rip off of that little dollar in our hand. But they are wrong. What is the significance of Christmas? And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father,
amen,
full of grace and truth. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
No one has seen the God at any time except the only begotten Son, who is in the bosom of God. Everything happened so suddenly. Why philosophers, why prophets, why religious leaders, why scribes and historians, we are still speculating and calculating and analyzing the astrological chart for the time the most expected Messiah will come and the form he will take. Is he coming in a fire chariot? Is he coming as a prince? God became man under their very nose. While all the creatures of the earth walk unaware, divinity arrived. Heaven opened herself and placed her most precious one in a human womb.
Amen.
God as a fetus. Holiness sleeping in a human womb. Life being created.
Amen.
God was given human eyes, ears, nose, mouth, arms to lift things, and legs to walk. To think of Jesus in such a light is just too much to comprehend. For God so loved the world.
Amen.
That he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
God has to use somebody to come to earth. Mary was a human being like you, and so was Joseph. If God can use Mary and Joseph, then you should ask yourself today, why not me? How were Mary and Joseph different from you? The story of Christmas, as read every year from the Bible, is simple and clear and well known to all of us, that there is nothing really we can add to the facts, but there are many lessons Christmas brings to us all every year, among any other religion or celebrations in the world.
Amen.
There is none other as universally observed with so much emotions, with so much pomp and ecstasy, and affecting all humanity, irrespective of your religion, your creed or belief, such as Christmas. But nevertheless, I will want us to ask ourselves this morning two pertinent questions. One about the mystery of Christmas we celebrate today, and the other about its meaning in your life and in my life. The why. Why of the incarnation of Christmas? Why do we celebrate Christmas? The question has baffled some people of all faith and belief to see the meaning and the spirit behind the reason why Christians celebrate Christmas. Rather, they limit themselves to arguments and human astrological charts. They spend their lives arguing about the actual date our Savior was born, and some even spent all their lives trying to find out the actual day before they will celebrate Christmas. Amen. The celebration of Christmas has over the decades been questioned and challenged by so many historical scholars and theologians, as well as believers of other religions, as a deliberate invention of the Roman Emperor Aurelian, who placed a pagan celebration on Christmas December 25th, in order to compete with the growing rate of the Christian church, which had already been celebrating Christmas on that date. Two, one reason, which the Bible confirmed, is God will it so. And for this reason, when he comes into the world, he says in Hebrews 10, 5 to 7, wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he said, sacrifice an offering thou wilt not, but a body hast thou prepared me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin thou hast no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book it is written of me, to do thy will, O God. Amen.
Amen.
And secondly, the Bible also provides us with another reason why all humanity should celebrate Christmas, as we read also in John 3:16, the Lord so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him should not perish,
amen,
but have everlasting life.
Yes.
These are good news, which the Nicene of the Orthodox churches have this to complement the Bible for us men, humanity. And for our salvation, he came down from heaven and was made man. For our salvation.
Amen.
This is the will of God, that Christ came down to fulfill salvation. That is God's love in giving to the world his Son, salvation. That was the good news of great joy to all people, that a Savior has been born. It is indeed good news that we will live forever in happiness with God, our Father. It is in good news that we are now children of God.
Amen.
As assured us in 1 John 3:1. Behold, what manner of love the Father had bestowed upon us,
Amen,
that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not.
Amen.
The mere fact that God surrendered his only begotten Son to us for our salvation, and the Son took on humanity despite all our handicaps and consequences, it is a great gift.
Amen.
A great sacrifice, especially to us Christians. And that salvation ought to be a hot priority in our personal life. The highest eternal salvation must be something far more valuable and far more important than most people rate it among their goals and reasons for living. Now, if salvation is a gift of God, but so dearly, we ought to take the trouble of reaching out to accept that gift. God reaches out to us. That is the plain message for Christmas. Message of the incarnation and the message of the coming of Christ to earth as man. Now, you have to reach out to God. If you refuse or hesitate to take the trouble, the gift will never be yours. God offers you salvation in Christ. He is not going to twist your arm and make you take it. How do you reach out and take it? By faith, motivated by love, Christ is God's supreme and ultimate revelation. Revelation is God's action. God is reaching out to us. Faith is our human response. Amen. Reaching out to meet God's outstretched hands. And I want you this morning to reach out to the one person to you to say, Merry Christmas. Jesus loves you.
Merry Christmas. Jesus loves you.
Touch the hand of God. Touch Christ with your faith.
Amen.
This reminds me of a touching story.
Amen.
I would like to share with you this morning.
Yes.
In a small town down south of America, once lived a young incompatible couple with two kids. Incompatible couples. The husband was a hard-hearted atheist, married to a very religious Christian woman. One day, during the winter season, the weather dropped to below freezing point. As you will imagine, what lives will be for all the people that had to walk outside at night. The road maintenance engineers clearing the snow from the roads. The paramedics and the police on patrol. And this is not to talk of those that have nowhere to sleep, referred to as the homeless we do see on our streets all the year round. And that reminds me of some of our church family members when Reverend and I were living in Greenbelt. That Reverend and I used to go to their places of work like giants in Greenbelt at 12 o'clock at night, waiting for them in our car to close, for them to close for the day and give them a ride back home. I used to watch them as they go into the car parking space, collecting all the shopping carts scattered all over the place in that freezing cold weather. I said, I think whether I'm going to work in America or not. What about the homeless? We really know who we are to sleep, since all the other grounds across the country are damp and full of wild, weird creatures you can imagine of, which they have to deal with. On one of these freezing nights, a homeless man was very hungry and tired of walking about. So he decided to knock at the door for a loaf of bread and water. He kept knocking until the door was opened to him by the atheist husband. As soon as he saw that it was a homeless at the door, he slammed back the door at his face. The homeless man did not give up. He knocked the door again and again until the wife asked the husband, who was knocking? When she was told that it was a homeless man, she got up towards the door, opened the door. Her heart was full of compassion for this helpless homeless man, that she asked him to come into the house and eat and warm up despite the objection and insults from her husband. In annoyance, the husband left the living room straight to their bedroom to sleep rather than have anything to do or say to this homeless man, because to him, all homeless people are victims of their wrong choices, lost opportunities, and laziness.
That's true.
His life was based on principles of positive thinking and effective business strategy to achieve continuous success. He never believed that you can ever fail or fall. This Christmas housewife, or this Christian housewife, remember that they have a spare room in the basement of their townhouse, which they just pack toys and empty boxes. And without telling her husband, he made a makeshift bed for this homeless man to sleep at least for that night. Everybody went to bed, except the homeless man, who remained wide awake, thinking of how his life has changed for the worse. From a company manager with wife and children and a house, but ended up a homeless in the basement of a Good Samaritan. And what will the husband say when he finds out that his wife had the audacity to let a complete stranger and a homeless man to sleep under the same roof with his family? I am sure none of you listening to me this morning will ever take those risky chances, and maybe including me too, in the middle of the night, because there were many heating devices turned on because of the severe cold weather. There was overload, and the electrical breaker circuit did not cut off, resulting in the electrical wires melting and setting the house on fire. The house was completely engulfed on fire, and the smoke got to the basement. This homeless man ran up to warn the family, who were fast asleep. The atheist husband just took his business briefcase and ran out shouting to his wife. And shouting, Elena, get the children.
Very minga.
Not my own Elena. The wife fell down and fainted. And had to be carried out by this homeless man. As the two kids were still in the burning house, this homeless man ran into the fire to rescue the 3-year-old boy while the baby was still in her cot. By this time, the fire has engulfed the whole building. But this homeless man, covering himself with wet blanket, ran back into the house and up the staircase to pick the baby. But the wooden staircase collapsed, so he had to open the small window in the attic to throw the baby to the hands of the waiting neighbors, while he unfortunately died in the burning fire, thereby sacrificing his own life to save that family. At his burial, the officiating pastor read one of the Lord's messages of grace in John 15:12-14. This is my command: love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, that someone would lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. He went on saying, if there's anyone here this morning who wants to give his life to Christ, this is an opportunity, as your deeds to your fellow neighbors will never go in vain. And surprisingly, this atheist man got up and gave his life to Christ there and then. Is that not what the death of Jesus Christ all about? He laid down his life so that you and I could be saved from the bondage of sin. So don't go through life as if you just descended from cosmos and you are not responsible to God or anybody for your life. And most of us today, not like this atheist man, that it has to take the sacrifice of a whole human life to save his soul. How many servants of God will come and go in this God's people church bringing God's messages to us in the last 80 years? And yet, no. And every passing year, they are adding age to their years. If they don't retire like some pastors, don't think they too don't get frustrated and get tired of dealing with the same bench woman Christian believers all the year round.
Amen. Praise him.
Abba.
Praise
him. Another lesson is that when you see somebody desperately in need of help, do something. You may never know when you are being visited by the angels of God to bless you as the angels bless Abraham and Sarah, or save you as the angels of God save Lot and his family.
Amen.
How can we apply this parable to our own circumstances? How can we draw on the wealth of salvation now made available to us, now on deposit, so to speak, with God and His church? How does our faith, in the sense of knowledge and belief, turn into faith in the sense of reaching out to draw on our salvation, which God is offering to us in Christ? Reaching out to draw it into our own personal life and make use of it. We have heard the answer already. Many answers or many forms of the same answers boil down to love God and keep His commandments, as we read in John 10:10-16.
Amen.
The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me.
Amen.
Just as the Father knows me, I know the Father.
Amen.
I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd.
Amen.
Among the many habits and values that qualify and distinguish you as a Christian and believer of Christ is getting to know Christ. You get to know someone by spending time with him or her. The only way to know Jesus is by meeting him here, present in his word, in this church.
Amen.
And Holy Communion here in our church. You will find the same Christ whom the shepherds found at Bethlehem. Through the messages of Angel Gabriel, God revealed to the band of shepherds the birth of his son. But they have to take the trouble of going to the manger themselves to have a look at the miracle baby. What the Bible did not tell us is whether all the shepherds left their flock and went there. There must have been some of those who heard the good news and made no effort to go and see the newborn baby, because either the place was too far or they were too busy. What would you have done or said if you had been one of those fortunate bands of shepherds to whom the good news was proclaimed that first Christmas night?
Amen.
What are you going to do about this Christmas day? As the good news of a Savior born is proclaimed to you again, the answer lies within your power.
Amen.
Christ has been born into the world to offer you salvation. What are you going to do? My advice to you is simply this: reach out and take it.
Amen.
While yet there is time. The gift of salvation is free, but only to those who reach out and take it.
Amen.
There are four main significant emotions of Christmas to the world, and which we Christians should always remember. Wonder. Wonder. Wonder, wonder, wonder. Of the emotions of Christmas, wonder. Luke attempts to give us the panoramic view of events leading to the arrival of Christ. An angel Gabriel appearing to a young virgin, announcing that she would be the surrogate mother of our Savior while she was already betrothed to a pious and righteous man called Joseph. If you ask me, that is wonder. This is what we call immaculate conception, which no other religions we know dispute. Nobody disputes it. I'm sure you'll understand what I mean by immaculate conception. Right. Before Joseph could reject the story of the Annunciation, as a cover up by Mary. Because Mary didn't have any boyfriend. She was very young. So how could you get pregnant as a virgin? So nobody believed it. And that's never happened again. Except some scientists are trying to dispute it now. To make people pregnant without So before Joseph could reject the story of the Annunciation as a cover up by Mary, the same angel appeared to him and told him what to do with the mother and the child.
Amen.
And as if that was not enough, a decree came from Tiberius Caesar compelling everybody to go and be counted according to their tribes. And this means they have to go from Nazareth with the unborn child to Bethlehem in Judea for the census exercise. Just as had been prophesied, that the hope of Israel will come from Bethlehem. Otherwise, Mary will have delivered this Christ in Nazareth conveniently. And as equally confirmed by the religious leaders when Herod asked them concerning the birth of the coming Messiah, that we just read Matthew 2, 5 to 6, and they said that to him in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, and thou, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Prophecy fulfilled in Christ. Ever before Jesus Christ was born, maybe 400 years, it was revealed. And this is another wonder. It was another wonder that some wise men came all the way from Mesopotamia in search of a newborn king in Israel who will rule the world, who is our Jesus Christ. They were warned not to go back to King Herod. Jesus Christ is described as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. This is another great wonder.
Amen.
It was another wonder. The child was taken away as a refugee to Egypt because Herod sought to kill him. And the flight to Egypt and the genocide of the male babies in Bethlehem all confirmed the prophecies that will herald the coming of the Messiah. If you remember what happened, what did Herod do? When he found out that he had been deceived by the wise men, he sent his soldiers to go and slaughter all male born from the age of 2 downwards in Bethlehem.
Yeah, you're right.
And that has also been prophesied a long time before Jesus Christ was born. Matthew 2, 15 to 17 says, and there was until the death of Herod that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet saying, out of Egypt have I called my son. Then Herod, when he heard that he was mocked by the wise men, was exceedingly wroth and sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coasts thereof from 2 years old under, according to the time which he had diligently acquired of the wise men. There was fulfilled another prophecy which was spoken by Jeremy, the prophet, saying, in Ramah was there a voice heard, lamentation and weeping and great mourning, Rachel, and will not be comforted because they are not. And I'm sure you still remember who is Rachel. Two old saints in their 90 years of age, 90 years of age, one woman, one man, in the temple, Simeon and Anna. If you remember again, when Joseph and Mary took Jesus Christ for the 8th day, circumcision, in the temple with the dove, they met two old people who refused to die until they see Christ. Simeon was one of them, very aged old man. So he stretched his hand to pick Jesus Christ from Mary's hand. And he told Mary, they could not die in peace now because in the face of her infant, they have seen the hope and fears of all the years. The old Simeon had this to say concerning the baby Jesus while holding him in his hand. Lord, now lest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word. For my eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all the people, a light to lighten the Gentiles, and the glory of thy people Israel. This is another wonder. At the age of 12, he was already a match for scholars in Israel. As we also read in Luke 2, 45 to 47, and when they did not find him, they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. This is another wonder. A young lad of 12 years from nowhere explaining the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven to religious leaders and teachers of law. And at the age of 30 years, Jesus became one of the greatest popular figures in the land of Israel the world had ever produced. As we also read in Mark 1, 21 to 22, they went into Capernaum. And immediately on the Sabbath day, he entered the synagogue and began to teach. They were amazed at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one having authority. Amen. And not as the scribes. Amen. He was not quoting any prophet. He was not quoting any scribe. He was talking as if to say he came from God. He was God. He is God. He was talking as one with authority. Was this not confirmed by a man from the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews? This man came to him at night and said, Rabbi, Master, we know that you have come from God as a teacher, for no one could perform these signs you do unless God were with him. Is this not another wonder? Yeah. And at the age of 33, Mary's son was nailed to the cross as a criminal, but who committed no sin, between two thieves. And Mary was there to watch him suspended between the earth and the sky and left in the scorching sun to die. Mother, watching her beloved son, hung on the cross and bleeding in pain to death, and she could do nothing to help him. That's another wonder. So you and I could be saved. John 15:13 says, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. What an incredible strain was put on that mother's love. Yet through it all, from the spectacular beginning to the uncertainty of his ministry to this crushing cross to the final victory, Mary loved her son dearly. Amen. She never gave him up. Amen. When we see her love, we wonder, what kind of love is this? Amen. When we think of the love of God for us, we wonder. We don't deserve.
Amen.
We deny God. We don't deserve, but still, he loved us. Even greater than Joseph's love for Mary, even greater than Mary's love for her son, is the love God had for us when he gave his only begotten son that we have just read in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That whosoever believed in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
And love is another emotion of Christmas. Matthew in his gospel wrote that three wise men came and presented the newborn baby with gifts. As we read in Matthew 2:11, and when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. That was display of love, which has hence been handed down from ages to us as we practice today that love in our life.
Amen.
At no season of the year do we feel warmer towards our fellow men than at Christmas, when you can reach out to complete strangers without fear of being rebuffed. It is at Christmas time that the spirit of Christmas moves you to present baskets, packages, and assorted gifts to other people. A time all supermarkets are decorated with Christmas trees, and Father Christmas, known as Santa Claus, are seen carrying little children. And available to now, we are a Santa Claus dress. Before you say it, and giving them gifts. A time people are buying greeting cards and reaching out to both Christians and non-Christians.
Amen.
This is the love that Christmas portends in our life. That is good, because if there's anything the world needs, it is love. Love might not make the world go round, but it makes the ride worthwhile. And we need more of Christmas.
Amen.
This is the spirit of Christmas, which the American government wants to take away from us by attempting to change the traditional salutations of Merry Christmas to Happy Holiday. What is Happy Holiday? So we Christian believers will not offend the minority of the non-believers.
Amen.
So this is another desperate. This is another desperate attempt by Satan to deny the Son of God of his messiahship. As we read in Revelation 12:1-6, and then a great wonder appeared in heaven. There was a woman who was clothed with the sun, and the moon was under her feet. She had a crown of 12 stars on her head. She was pregnant and cried out with pain because she was about to give birth. Then another wonder appeared in heaven. There was a giant red dragon there. The dragon has 7 heads with a crown on each head. It also had 10 horns. It still swept a third of the star out of the sky and threw them down to the earth. It stood in front of the woman who was ready to give birth to the baby. It wanted to eat the woman's baby as soon as it was born. The woman gave birth to a son who will rule all the nations with an iron rod. And her child was taken up to God and to his throne. Hallelujah. The woman ran away into the desert to a place that God has prepared for her.
Oh, yes.
There she will be taken care of for 1,260 days. That is another wonder.
Amen.
Joy. It's another emotion of Christmas. Joy.
Amen.
Joy to the world. The Lord has come. How vividly that song expresses our emotions at Christmas. I am talking about the deep joy we feel in our hearts that we can have personal Jesus. Throughout her whole life was a deep sense of joy, which came from her awareness of the part God was allowing her to play in the redemption of the world. Her joy was expressed in song in Luke 1:46-48. And Mary said, "My soul doth magnify the Lord. And my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior, for he has regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed."
Amen.
Amen. Amen. The angels felt joy over Jesus. We bring you good tidings of great joy, they said. Why? Because this one whose birth they herald was to become the Savior of the world. Simeon and Anna in the temple felt joy over Jesus. Why? Because of the hope which the promised child brought to them in the midst of their problems. When we realize again the significance of what happened on that special night long ago, we too should feel joy.
Amen.
To realize that God loves us enough to come all the way down to where we are so we can become what He is, that brings joy.
Amen.
To realize that this Jesus whose birth we celebrate is one who can meet every need and provide every solution to our problem and satisfy every longing of our soul, that brings joy.
Amen.
We'll be talking about joy. And it also brings sadness. Another emotion of Christmas is sadness, which is not a contradiction of what we have been saying above. We have to appreciate the fact that even in the midst of all the joy of Christmas, there are still many who find Christmas as a moment of depression and unfulfilled wishes. Sometimes the sadness of the Christmas season is caused by the awareness that the future will not be exactly like the past, especially in our declining economy, due to ungodly actions of some corrupt politicians, resulting in famine, loss of job, high rates of unemployment, leading to loss of their dear ones and homes, many human tragedies like civil war, terrorist attack, tragic fire accident causing the deaths of many, and destruction of properties, uprising all over the world, and natural disasters. Christmas meeting some on the hospital sick bed, while many are in prison or detention camps, being tortured for their religious beliefs and faith, like many Africans in Libya being sold as slaves. Can they celebrate Christmas? Of course not. There are millions in refugee camps all over the world, while many homeless are staring us in the face in our own state and communities to remind us of God's great mercy upon us.
Amen.
Some of the sadness is inevitable. The financial demands of the Christmas season are depressing at times. This fact is known well to some of us leaders, as we are usually bombarded with cries and pleads and text messages from different people all over the world for financial help. And that's why Reverend Lambo is always broke. At Christmas, so that you could buy food and celebrate Christmas. I am sure our Lord Jesus Christ must have been faced with so many of these human needs as he spent his entire life among the poor people and downtrodden. There are some people whose lives are empty. The facing of Christmas alone does hurt. But the discovery of the true meaning of Christmas will dispel much of it. And we have this assurance that if Christmas means anything, it means hope. It means fulfillment. It means peace. Peace comes because we do not march to the drumbeat of the world, but to the drumbeat of the King of Kings. Fulfillment comes not from the delicacy on the world's table, but from the one who is the bread of life. Hope comes not from a denial of death, but from the realization that not even death can eternally separate us from those we lost, but now resting in the bosom of Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Let us keep Christmas beautiful, without a thought of greed, that it might live forever, forevermore, to fill our every need, that it shall not be just a day, but last a lifetime through the miracle of Christmas time.
Amen.
That brings God close to us. I wish you all the joys and blessings of Christmas. and a prosperous new year.
Amen.
Amen.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.